Hi, this is Lorraine, and I'm doing another video. If you'll give me a second to clear center and balance my energy, we'll get started. Okay. Let's see, where do I start? Certain things I've just become very disciplined in doing, and I do these things regularly. And when I went into clearing my energy, it was just like everything was being done for me. And I'm not sure. Like, being idle is not what I'm good at. I'm always working and doing something, even if I'm sitting on the couch. Like, I have information coming in, I'm working, clearing energy, working with fields, something. But when I closed my eyes, there was just this, everything was happening already. So I felt a little, I don't know how I put it. So I guess maybe it's like, what's next then? If I've done what I'm meant to do up to this point, what comes next? So I get a little break. And so, because this week I had 3 days where I really didn't write much, or 2 days where I really didn't write much. And I thought, maybe I'm getting a break, but which I always learn is not the case. There's always something that starts coming in, which is what happened. But I'm just gonna get started. We'll just get started. April 25, April 25th, in and out of phase. So I'm going to read this, but as I was writing it, it was very difficult. And I felt like what I was writing didn't make sense. And I haven't gone over it again since I wrote it, but I felt very... I felt like I was resisting what I was supposed to be writing because I didn't want to say it, if I'm completely honest. So I'm just going to read it, and then I'm going to say what it is I felt but didn't actually write on the paper, okay? In and out of phase. Visions of people trying to do what I do, say what I say. The message comes in, you cannot usurp someone else's sole purpose. We all have something we are meant to do on this world, in this lifetime. That journey, that path and purpose is found within. Connect to the divine through the heart center to find your journey. Through this journey of awakening, I felt overwhelmed and moved, mind, body, and spirit. I've felt and witnessed all parts of me change. I've physically moved from the San Francisco Bay Area to Seattle, and I have witnessed continuous change in my physiology as well as consciousness. These changes felt mostly like jolts, going back as far as 2013, but mostly starting around 2015 in 2016. I would experience waves of information coming in through claircognizance and clairsentience. Hindsight is 2020, because I didn't know what claircognizance and clairsentience was back then. I would experience massive shifts in my energy field, causing fatigue, requiring a lot of rest. My then husband criticized me often causing stress, anxiety, insecurity, which wreaked havoc on my emotional body. It has been like being on an emotional roller coaster. Quick starts and abrupt slowing, no stopping, rolling and shifting energy, slamming into and sideswiping walls, massive highs and lows, relentless and seemingly unending. Reprieves were found in moments where the connection with the divine source consciousness was profound and undeniable, even if I couldn't describe those experiences with words in those moments. And so, just basically, there were moments where I would just kind of be taken out into the void. But at that time, somebody had said to me, they call it the everything nothing place, which kind of made sense to me. And maybe that place for that person is different than what I'm experiencing, but it's just a calm, quiet place with nothing, no stars, no, it's just a void. Okay, so I didn't know then what was happening, but I would be moved into these places that I now know, or I would call the void. I'm telling you this because these transitions, shifts I've been going through have been jarring, startling, staggering, unforeseeable, off-putting, extraordinary, and ultimately empowering. There has been nothing easy or even beautiful about this transition, mind, body, and spirit, except for the absolute love I feel. With every thought and acceptance of divine love, as well as the realization or understanding of what it means to be eternally connected to all things, to be all things, to live in the flow of energy and begin the journey back to wholeness, oneness, unity. I sit in a place where there are no more jolts, startling shifts, or transitions. Now it is about fine-tuning, honing, drawing in this feeling. I keep on seeing snow like on the old TVs, the old school TVs with old school rabbit ear antenna. We used to have to fine-tune the TV reception to get a clear picture on any television channel. So, anybody that's close to my age, I'm 56, if you had the old school TVs when we only had three TV channels that were played shows from like 5 or 6 a.m. to, 2 a.m., I think it was. We didn't have cable, we had TV antenna. And so the TV antenna, we called them rabbit ears, sat on top of the television set. And you would have to adjust these antenna to get a clear reception. And so if I can find some pictures, I'll do a picture in picture. But if you didn't have a clear picture, or if there's no picture, there would be this static on the TV that looked like snow. And which we used to call snow. That's what I keep seeing is that snow. I am fine-tuning my understanding of my inner divinity. I am fine-tuning my understanding of myself and my universe in relation to all other things and/or realities. And so that's the message. Like when I see that snow, I have to adjust the rabbit ears to get a clear picture, right? So right now, what I'm doing is adjusting, making small, minute adjustments to my field and my perception of reality, and my connection to all things. as I reconcile this idea of who I am in relation to all other things, a new kind of deconstruction takes place. We can no longer see ourselves as separate. We must understand our connection to all things, and in order to do so, we must see ourselves from a different perspective. We must see all things around us from a different perspective. The first step from my place, my perspective in this change in awareness is the construct of telepathic communication. There will be no secrets. This fine-tuning of perspective and perception hones our energy field and elevates our consciousness, skill set, abilities. Although this completely oversimplifies what is happening, this change is affecting all things. Nothing will ever be the same. This truth might be frightening to some, but it is the most comfort and settled I've ever felt in my lifetime. Once you release and trust in the flow of energy, you come to understand what flow is, what its purpose is, and how it carries us through this experience. It is the trust in the flow that protects us. To resist the flow creates friction, resistance, and creates imbalances. I'll read that one more time. It is the trust in the flow that protects us. To resist the flow creates friction, resistance, and creates imbalances. It is the release of control, the relinquishing of friction, that fluently and fluidly unifies divine consciousness. Maybe it wasn't as confusing as I thought, because that's pretty clear, right? So if I'm going to summarize that, I would just say that's my understanding, my reconciliation of my divine light within, what it means for me to exist in this universe, in my universe, and how I affect all things around me. So right now, I'm reconciling and fine-tuning how I affect all things around me. And so if I'm thinking about that, how I reconcile how I affect all things around me is how I see the connection. And that perception comes through that telepathic connection to all things, okay? So there's no lies, and I have to see things for what they are. And that comes through my acceptance of flow, my acceptance of that flow of energy, allowing that information to flow in and come back, flow out and come back in, and then understanding, receiving the information on the connections. So as I project my energy out, my perceptions out, to, let's say, I have my plant Gracie right over here, and that plant Gracie can reflect back her perception of the reality that she's experiencing here on this plane in my apartment, right? And so we're bouncing, that energy's bouncing back and forth. We're reflecting back and forth to one another. And that's true of all things around me, okay? Even my stones that I have here, my flowers that I have here, my stones, I have stones over here, all things, okay? All energy can, you know, even my, you know, pots and pans, you know, my TV, my photos, my books, like all energy carries a vibration and carries information that can be communicated back and forth, okay? Also including people, of course, right? All right. 4/27, April 27th. The surface of the earth is like a big scab ready to be picked. ready to be picked off. Wounds heal, scars fade. We will witness the power of unconditional love, and so will the universe. We transition this world from balance. We create and manifest the rebirth of Mother Earth with Mother Earth. This is the beginning. Okay, 428, April 28th. And I have a note here from the last video. As a collective, humanity has a karmic debt to the universe as a whole. Okay, so I'm just going to explain. I talked about the Zeta Reticuli, the Cabal, I mean, and how we are, as a collective, responsible for the negativity they brought to the universe as a whole. Okay, and so this, I think, explains that a little bit more. As a collective, humanity has a karmic debt to the universe as a whole, but there are many kinds of karmic debts. We can also have individual karmic debt, family, organizations we've affiliated with in the past or present. When we work towards aligning ourselves with individuals, organizations, or smaller collectives, I have that in quotation marks, smaller collectives, just kind of like the royal family, that is a small collective, right? We create a karmic bond with that thing and all the karmic energy related to that bond, be it positive or negative. And so I think the royal family is, or any royal family is a good example. They are connected through their relations to one another, through their position, their role in as a family, as part of their government or their country, and their actions as a unit, as a smaller collective, carries a karmic value. And so whatever their karmic debt is, whether it is something that's positive or negative, they carry it as a unit, okay? This cabal energy has a deep karmic debt as a group within the human collective. They have a debt to humanity as well as the universe. It makes sense that they would not want to incarnate. So when I say not want to incarnate, I mean they transitioned that a part of that cabal energy became the Zeta Reticuli. Okay, and then as this new collective, this breakaway organization, civilization, they as a group decided to release the physical form, so they destroyed their physical bodies and became pure consciousness, or housed their consciousnesses within this housing unit. I'm just going to call it a housing unit. So all of these consciousnesses from this cabal energy are housed in this one location that we'll just call a housing unit, okay? They've created bodies, physical forms, that they can transfer those consciousnesses into so they can be mobile and move around their world or the universe as a whole, okay? And so that was their conscious choice to do that, all right? And so by doing that, they're not dying and reincarnating like we do, okay? Because they've destroyed the physical body and never reunified with unity, okay? And I've talked a lot about that collective psychosis that they're experiencing and a bunch of stuff in other videos. And maybe I'll talk about that again in the future, but that's not what I'm going to talk about right now. Or I've talked about the consequences of that choice that they've made, but I'm not going to go into that right now. So it makes sense that they would not want to incarnate, and then Zeta Reticuli, I have that in parentheses, to begin the work to release that karmic debt will be an arduous journey, but nonetheless, a journey that will be undertaken. for no one escapes the karmic cycle. So even though they're trying to escape that karmic debt, they're trying to usurp the divine and kind of take over the universe. This is very low vibration thinking. This is 3D vibration. That's not possible. But from this place of separation, they believe that they can do this because they believe they're separate from the source, the source of creation, the source that created all things, including them. They believe they're separate, but we are truly not separate. This is a construct. Separation is a construct. Okay. So, and it makes sense, you know, if you think about all the really bad things they've done, there is a deep, deep karmic debt. Okay, and so I'm going to talk more about that later. Actually, I'm going to talk about it right now. I work with many light workers, and one thing I know for sure, we help each other with the burden of our karmic debt. We help each other carry and dispel this energy. But each of us must awaken to the light worker beside us. We must see them and trust in their journey. In their journey to assist us. I actually added that. In these days, so many of us are deeply traumatized. To trust is a tall order. But to overcome this hurdle is to start the journey to freedom. The prison we live in is a prison of the mind. Our fears, insecurities, defensiveness are the chains and shackles that have been placed upon us. The tools we use or that we have been convinced are effective tools of protection, aggression, control, confrontation, oppression of, dominion over, these things galvanize the control this unbalanced energy carries over us. As we perpetuate this unbalanced energy, we willfully sit in the heart of darkness. By allowing them to manipulate, lead, and control our thoughts, we choose the prison of the mind. Those who choose to look within and find their inner divinity, connect with the heart, and in turn, seek, find, and acknowledge not their connection with the divine, but their divine root. Tap into it and empower themselves from this place. It is in these moments that we begin the journey to unification. We free ourselves from the ties that bind us and journey to wholeness, oneness, unity. And so the next is my daughter showed me this picture, and it was she goes, Mom, look at this picture of the rainbow I took. And it was a beautiful picture of a rainbow, but it was, the rainbow was in a bubble. And I'm like, where did that light come from? The rainbow looks like it's in a bubble. And so all this information started coming in. And so, the rainbow, it represented expansion, the bubble, protection, and cycles. And then it was in front of this building, which has a very negative, where my daughter had, in front of the high school she went to, the public high school she went to, where she had all this pretty negative stuff happen. And so, I'm gonna read what I wrote. From the protection of the bubble or field, we expand our consciousness, our awareness in plain sight amongst the chaos of the 3D. And so we, and even she, from this higher level of consciousness, from this perspective, are witnessing the trauma of this 3D world. We're witnessing the darkness of this 3D world from this place of protection, from this field of protection, and also from a place of expansion, because even though all this negativity or this unbalanced energy is happening around us, we sit in this, in these protective fields, expanding our consciousness and our awareness of the world around us, okay? Powerful light workers advising, guiding both balanced and unbalanced energies. Okay. And so, as I'm going, as this information is coming in, I'm so how do I put this? So many light workers go into the darkness because there must be light in the darkness. And we go through to experience the darkness, to witness the darkness, and to gain knowledge of the darkness. Because we need to know and understand what this darkness is in order to heal it. I don't want to say combat it, because we can't combat the darkness, right? Violence begets violence. And we can surround that energy with love to heal it. But I feel like to have, truly feel compassion and empathy for the struggle, we have to understand it. Okay, we have to experience it. We can always surround that energy from love, right? But I'm getting the example I give of addiction. So my brother's going into rehab, right? And they always have counselors who are sober, who are participating, because these people need someone who has been through it to be able to relate to what they're going through to help them, right? Because you can read books all day long, but unless you've dealt with that struggle of addiction, you really can't relate to what that person's going through, okay? And I, you know, as someone who's been molested, I would say unless you've had some, that betrayal happen to you, that specific one, it's hard to really relate to what I feel like. Someone talking to me about it can help me understand certain elements of the trauma, but I feel like a person who's experienced it would have a much better understanding of the root of that trauma, if that makes sense. And I think that is an experience that we go through at these lower levels of consciousness. We go through these traumatic experiences to have them. And then these traumatic experiences are lessons in compassion and empathy and kindness and patience and understanding and acceptance, right? We can't judge people for what they've gone through. And what comes to me now is, like, in the past, women who have been raped were blamed because of the clothes they were wearing. Oh, she was wearing very suggestive clothes, so that's why. And over the years, we've come to understand rape is an act of violence. It's about control, it's about domination. It's not about sex, right? And so we had to go through this shift in understanding, right? In order to really have this deep-seated understanding of these traumas, we have to experience it to be able to truly show compassion for what the person's going through. Because clearly someone who is saying that someone being raped and wearing suggestive clothes being the cause of it doesn't understand what transpired in that act of violence, right? They're making an incorrect assumption because they've never been there, okay? Or they're making an argument, not really caring about what the root is, just trying to make an argument to get their client off, right? But to really be able to understand what's happening, why it's happening, we have to understand, and I want to say experience it. We have to experience it to be able to truly show compassion. Okay. Okay. So powerful light workers advising, guiding both balanced and unbalanced energies. As we incarnate throughout lifetimes, many of us have taken on roles as advisors. We advise many leaders, balanced and unbalanced. We come into these lifetimes with the intention to guide these leaders from balance in hopes of maintaining that balance. Often we work with unbalanced energies hoping to guide these individuals into balance. We are not always successful and we carry the karmic consequences of these lifetimes. So even though we come into these lifetimes and we maybe have become or are advisors to very violent, unbalanced energies, leaders, okay, and we work towards trying to help them move into a, from a more balanced perspective, we are still advising in these endeavors of oppression or violence and war, right? And so even from our roles, we still carry the karmic consequences of those actions because we were participants in those events, okay? This is why it is so important for us to work together. We work together with a goal in mind. We generate and release karmic consequences. Together as a group, we are never alone. Okay. And so, but even with that, and so I talk about the three, the Oracle and the three fates are good examples of earthly guides from the past. To make such predictions can carry karmic consequences. And so the Oracle or the three fates, and this is, come from Greek, history and mythology, and these oracles and fates advised all anybody who came to see them whether they were coming from a balanced or unbalanced energy. And so they would always give the visions that came to them. So even if this person was an unbalanced energy and they're asking, how do I win, they would tell them what the visions that came, right? And so neutrally, without judgment, and there's always karmic consequences on both sides for what these people are doing, okay? And it's hard to say, I think this might be, it's hard to say, but sometimes we go into very dark places intentionally and experience very dark things. Like, I'm going to say the special forces again. I'm going back to that because I think they go into, I feel like they go into the military with the intention of good, protecting the things they love, freedom, family, country, right? And then they end up in these roles where they are very aggressive, violent, in very aggressive, violent situations. And they may not always be doing the best thing. And yet they are in this role, they've chosen this role, and they're just gonna follow it through, okay? And so I think we all come into these lifetimes with, and sometimes into these roles that can be morally questionable. Okay, that's the best way to put it, morally questionable. And I know I have. And so I have a very profound group that I incarnate with over many lifetimes. And we have gone through some really hairy things. And every lifetime that we come out of, we're always supporting each other and helping each other carry and deal with our karmic debt. I think that's in a nutshell what I'm trying to say, is that at the root, we're always helping each other. We always have a clear path and purpose and intention, and sometimes it's very difficult, but we're always present for each other, But we have to acknowledge the light worker to the right and left of us that's here to help us. Recognize and acknowledge that, and then trust them. And when you've been through a lot of traumas, a lot of darkness, and seen how betrayal on a very deep level, it's very hard to trust. And so I'm going to keep going. Our energies are aligned by our vibration. We do not have to think about it. It just is. We should not try to force it. And so we, as we work together as light workers, our vibration naturally aligns with one another. So we shouldn't try to force ourselves to align with other people. And we see that a lot. When I was in high school, we used to call them cliques. I don't know what they're called now, but oh, I want to hang out with that group. I want to hang out with that group. The jocks, we used to call them the yuppies or the preppies. We have the kids that were really smart, you know, the chess club or math club. We had the debaters. We had, did I say jocks already? We had the jocks. We had the stoners. We used to call them stoners. And you would just, you know, I'm going to hang out with that group. So you'd go to that group and try to become like them, to hang out with them, right? So you're trying to align your vibration to so that you fit with that group. And what I'm trying to say is that's not where we're at anymore. From this place of transcendence, we will align our energies based on our vibration. And the people who are aligned with us will naturally be drawn to us and will naturally be drawn together, okay? Okay, so wounded healers, there are many wounded healers. Their traumas are deep. Then I have Richard the delivery guy was not happy. Okay. Oh, this is the today. This is the 29th. I didn't add the date. There are many wounded healers. They are still working through their traumas. So there's so much information that came in the last 3 days, and I really couldn't get it all. So some of it's coming in, and some of it's written down. And so I'm getting a little, if the information's getting a little out of order or confusing, I apologize. But I'm trying to kind of fold in this information that's coming in with it. But I feel very, I don't want to say disconnected, but it's very disconnected. There are many wounded healers. They are still working through their traumas. There are deep, deep wounds that are keeping these individuals in a defensive state. It's the wars. Okay, so as I was writing that, I didn't put it down here, but it's, so let me just keep going. I'm tapping into a lot of feminine energies that have similar traumas to mine. So in this lifetime, so emotional trauma, sexual trauma, physical trauma. We've worked through most of our trauma and carry an incredible amount of strength in our emotional body. I also see us fighting in many wars in past lives. I feel an incredible amount of strength in the mind and emotional body. So I'm seeing a lot of women from this lifetime here that have similar traumas as mine in this lifetime, okay? And so from us working through our traumas, we have very strong emotional body. We have a very strong emotional body. But then also I'm seeing them in us in past lives fighting as male in wars, okay? And I always see this vision in very old, like it's Roman gladiators, these very old battles with these large weapons, hand-to-hand combat with these very heavy uniforms. And so I'm seeing myself with these women here in this lifetime, but as men in past lives. And it's showing me an incredible amount of strength, not only in the emotional body, but the mind. Because what it takes to go into that type of battle, it's really strengthen the mind, physical strength, but also strengthen the mind knowing that you're going to be going into these hand-to-hand combat, very visceral, guttural, violent circumstances. Okay, and so what I'm seeing is the divine feminine in past life wars, and then present, like trauma, childhood trauma, and then presently healed. Okay, so I'm going past life, past lives, and then from this life, our childhood, and then to the present. Okay, and then what I'm seeing, this divine masculine, I'm seeing them, their divine feminine in past lives. I'm seeing them presently as soldiers in our wars today, and then their present state of mind as a result. We are being asked to create, and so they're present, they're wounded healers. They're very, very wounded and still in that wounded state. That's what I'm being shown. We are being asked to create healing spaces. We do this by creating a field around these individuals with the intention of healing, aiding in awakening to assist in the raising of vibration. I'll let you figure out what that means for you. So whatever that means for you in setting up protective fields to help with the healing, to help awaken them and raise their vibration, okay? Okay. And so Richard, the delivery guy. So I've had a couple energies walk in this week to my job of Earth, humans. One very light, high vibratory, definitely a white hat. So there was a man that came in, definitely a white hat, came in, very light in his energy. And the other one was wearing a not so white hat. I called him Richard, the delivery guy. He walked in with one of our regular FedEx delivery drivers. The regular driver was nervous and unsettled. He was wondering what he, Richard, was doing. The FedEx driver was in his usual attire. The other guy, Richard, was in dark clothes with those, and then he had one of those yellow crossing guard vests. I would call them crossing guard vests or construction worker vests. So he could be seen, right? Richard hands me the package, confirms my first initial last name, messes with his little gadget thing, and then walks out. Richard is about 6'5", physically fit, older, mid-40s up to maybe early 50s. Definitely he had special forces training, definitely. He's pissed, frustrated, whatever he's doing is beneath him. So coming in was beneath him. As soon as he turned his back to me, I couldn't help but giggle. He was behaving very much like a pouty child, throwing a fit in his own way. He was thinking, and so he was not happy to be there. He was angry, and all the things I just said. He was thinking how close he was to me and how easy it would be to kill me. I saw him grab my arm and with one move sever it from my body. Not killing me, but sending a warning. In another thought, he stabbed me in the jugular. He thought to himself, I wouldn't even need to run. He could just like walk out and that would be it. Because literally anybody could walk up to my desk at work. It's not a big thing. People walk up to my desk all the time. There are many wounded healers that we must help. Richard is living from the, and so I got the name Richard. I went after, like, at the end of the day, I was like, should I talk about this? Should I not talk about this? I wasn't going to talk about it, but it just kept coming in so intensely. And every time it came in, more information, more information, more information. So I felt like definitely it was something that needed to be talked about. And I thought, I want a name. Can I get a name? And I never get names. Whenever I do readings, whenever I'm doing mediumship and somebody comes through, I never get a name. But this time it came in straight away, Richard. And it also came in that he did not like being called Richard. And then I kind of started making some jokes, and he did not like that. But he does not like to be called Richard. He likes to be called by his last name and his rank and his last name, but never by his first name. So there are many wounded healers that we must help. Richard is living from the old paradigm. Richard is fighting for what he believes in the way he was trained to do so. Right now, Richard does not see or understand how the world is changing. Some have awakened, some are awakening, others will awaken. There are many powerful wounded healers that need the assistance of the healed divine feminine. This behavior is conditioned. The expectation of what is masculine has been distorted, and from where Richard has been, the distortion and conditioning has created profound imbalance. He sends a message of the work before us. So this energy coming in, he may have been sent in for a different reason, but the message to me was there are a lot of wounded healers that need our healing. And so when I was talking earlier previously about the divine feminine coming in and setting up protective bubbles around these energies to help heal, this is what inspired that message, all the messages that came in about Richard. When I see Richard's thoughts on the many ways he could kill me, I also see a meme I shared with a coworker. And so I'll do a picture in picture because I have it. And so this was funny. It just made me laugh. It's from last year sometime. But all these visions came in, and I was like, wow. Then this vision, the meme came in right after that, after all these really aggressive visions of how the many ways he could kill me. So the Babylon Bee, I'm going to just show you just because I feel like I need to, posted this on social media, and it said, brand new tactical knife is the same one used by Navy SEALs to open their wives' Amazon packages. And so I thought that was hysterical because it was just, to me, I never read the article, but it was about the emasculation of men, really, right? So the Navy SEALs that have all this training no longer can use it. They are reduced to using their tactical knives to open packages for their wives. And so that vision came in after all those visions that Richard projected into my thoughts, into my mind. And so I'm just going to keep reading. The vision was not to belittle Richard. It was to show me how ineffectual or misguided his thoughts were. In my presence, the only thing his knife would be good for is opening packages. What that means is clearly his orders were not to touch me. If his orders were to harm me, and if he walked up to me with the intention to hurt me, he would fail. As he started his journey to me, he might have had, as he started his journey to me, he might have a heart attack. So if he came to me, I can't read this. If he came to me with the intention to cause harm, before he got to me, or by the time he got to my field, he would have a heart attack, he would have a stroke, something like that would happen to stop him from hurting me. He might, on the route over, get in a car accident or something, but something would happen to stop him from hurting me. It would stop him from fulfilling that goal, okay? This is the gift of abundance provided me. I also do not live from a 3D perspective. His actions come from fear, insecurity, and need to control. Those are not constructs that exist in my paradigm. I do not live from fear. I cannot be intimidated. I am committed to my path and purpose. I work diligently to maintain clear-centered, balanced energy, acknowledge my inner divinity, embody my heart center, and be who I am meant to be in this moment on this world. I will not stop. I will not be stopped. It doesn't matter what this unbalanced energy attempts. It doesn't matter what their intentions are. It doesn't matter, because I will fulfill my goal. I will fulfill my path and purpose. And the moment that I am done with what I am here to do, that knife can go in my neck and I will be released from this body, and I will move to my next obligation, whatever it is I'm meant to do, whatever it is I desire to do in this universe. This is who I am. This is what I do. And I do it confidently without fear, because fear is no longer a construct in this lifetime. I've overcome those things. And my words are not in any way to insult or marginalize Richard in any way. But I won't be stopped. It doesn't matter what you think. It doesn't matter what you want to do or what you think you can do. It's not possible. It goes against the flow of energy. And I live within the flow. I don't really think there's more to say. I feel like we're over a big hump. And I just feel like I should say, I won't stop. There's nothing that's gonna stop me. I feel like that snowball building up momentum on that hill, getting bigger as it goes down that hill. I feel myself aligning with other light workers in the 5D, and I feel us coming together in the 3D soon. And I don't know what soon is, but it's a feeling that started at the solar eclipse. I see myself aligning. I feel myself aligning. And it's powerful energy. And even though I'm talking about all this other stuff, always the children. Always the children are in my field. And I'm always working diligently for them. I will not be stopped. Nothing will stop me. Divine will be executed, is being executed. I am the light from which all things come. I am everything, everywhere, and nowhere. I permeate all things. Unified always, never apart. That's it. Thank you.